Thanks for joining us at the Business Growth Cafe, where each week we select from a menu of topics for a focused discussion with an industry expert to provide insights that can impact your business's growth. With your host, Angelo Ponzi.
I am Angelo Ponzi, your host here at the Business Growth Cafe, and thank you for joining us. Each week we select from a menu of topics that can impact growth to discuss with experts from a wide variety of disciplines. And today at the cafe, I'm very excited to have Stephanie Pottick, president of Pottick Law, on our show to discuss the importance of protecting your trademarks, copyrights, and overall your IP. Stephanie, welcome.
Thank you for having me, Angelo, and hello everyone watching and listening.
Hello there out there in Facebook land. We're very excited that you're joining us. Before to get things going, why don't you take a few minutes and tell the audience about who you are and your service before we get going.
Sure. So Pottick Law helps companies make money and keep them out of trouble. Our slogan is legal advice before you need a lawyer. Whatever you can do up front should help in the long run, minimize lawsuits and help create value for the company. Before becoming an attorney, I actually worked in the toy industry and have extensive business experience. So that helps me understand the client's point of view and helps me provide more practical solutions to help them protect their businesses and their brands.
Oh, fantastic. Is your tagline trademark?
It is. Registered trademark.
All right. Check I just want up. To check because we might be ending the show early if IP lawyer didn't register her own mark. Before we get started, you know, I'm always asked sometimes about a trademark versus a copyright versus registered trademark. Can you explain a little bit before we get going so we put things in context for the audience?
Sure. There are different types of intellectual property, including some that you also haven't mentioned, but I focus basically on trademarks and copyrights. A trademark basically protects a source identifier for your brand. So think of Coca-Cola, the Nike swoosh, and it doesn't have to be a name or a logo. It can also be something else like a smell. So did you know that Hasbro recently trademarked the smell of Play-Doh?
I did not.
Yes. So that's a new trademark.
That could open up a whole new vertical, couldn't it?
Yeah. There are certain trademarks that that are not typical, but it's something that you identify with that product, so it's protectable. The difference between a regular, just a trademark, trademark rights do accrue with use at common law, so those are state rights, but a registration you can only get by filing and getting acceptance and approval for registration with the U.S. Patent and Trademark
Office.
Is
that Office. The circle R that you see?
That's okay. The circle R, correct.
All right.
Correct. And copyright effectively protects a creative original work as it's put into fixed form. So think of a Star Wars movie, which I love Star Wars, a Beatles song, a logo, like Apple, the Apple logo, Nike swoosh. Anything like that.
So those are copyrighted and trademark, though?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The, so
just because
protections.
You have one. That's right. It doesn't have to be mutually exclusive. That's a great point.
Can you you just gave me an example of Apple. Is there any other practical applications and examples when someone would use a TM versus going after a registered
mark? Oh, sure. You know, you can use a TM pretty much anytime, even if you don't file an application, just as long as you feel comfortable that no one else is using that mark and it's yours. Otherwise, you would have to wait to use the R in a circle. You can only use it basically after you get the registration.
Okay. The now the process for that, it's obviously that's what you do. Is that a lengthy process? Is that an expensive process? Because we're going to talk a little bit later about what if you don't have those and
right.
Somebody uses your information or worse, you use somebody else's copyrighted material. So what's kind of that process that to make that happen?
So for a trademark, it typically takes between 12 and 18 months. And that's if you're using it in commerce in connection with the goods and services you are applying for. Otherwise, if you're filing an intent to use, you have up to 3 years after approval, what they call the notice of allowance, to actually use it in commerce and then actually demonstrate that to the trademark office.
Then how is an individual's rights or business's rights protected? if I use somebody's copyrighted trademark? How does that kind of play out? And before you answer that question, let me segue to a better description of that. So on the internet, there is tons of pictures and all sorts of different things. And a lot of people don't think twice. I admit I have been guilty in that way in the past, if you're listening, folks. But now...
Don't admit.
I don't admit. I won't tell you which one I did, but I put it back really fast. Is people have this tendency to just go grab a picture off the internet because they think because it's there, it's free.
Right.
But the reality is somebody else really owns that. So what's free, what isn't free, and what kind of trouble can someone get into by using somebody else's, let's say, photograph or talking about their trademark and not giving them the proper credit?
I get that a lot. People always say, well, it's on the internet, it's on social media, I should be able to use it. But unfortunately, most of the times, it's probably a copyrighted image. So that means someone else owns it and has the rights to use it and the rights to control who uses it. So if you pull something off the internet and someone finds you, let's say Getty Images is a good example because that's what they do. They have a number of images that they've protected, and they search different websites and blogs and look for the, you know, unauthorized use of their images. And they'll send a letter and say, basically, you know, we found you using it. It doesn't matter if it's a blog, doesn't matter if you intended to, it doesn't matter if you made money from it. We're going to, you know, they threaten to sue for up to $150,000, which is per copyright violation.
Per copyright.
It's under the copyright statute. That's why it's very, very smart to get a copyright registration if you can. Very cost effective, and the damages are, you know, sometimes disproportionate. So
that certainly could have an impact on your bottom line if you're getting hit with a $150,000 federal lawsuit.
Sure. Well, for some people, and that's just the damage, some people that would bankrupt their company. And legal fees also with litigation can get to be $100,000, $200,000, and more.
Can you give me an example of a situation where somebody used a trademark when they shouldn't have been?
Or it's copyright. So you're thinking more of the image. Yeah. Well, trademark infringement is different. Effectively, if you own the intellectual property, it's your duty to police it in the marketplace. So if you have a trademark, you have to look and make sure that others aren't using it. It is your duty to police it. So if you find something, you'll send a cease and desist you know, you'll analyze what the issue is. And then, of course, with the copyright, you have all those extra potential damages that you can get. But on the receiving end, if you have a website, this is the best thing for anyone to take away today. If you have a website, a blog, whatever it is, don't use something that's not uniquely yours or that you didn't license from an online company.
Okay.
And then there's a caveat.
All right.
When you license something online, you should read the terms and conditions because, again, I've had clients come to me and say, oh, I have this free site. I can use their images for free. And I said, well, hold on. Let's read the terms and conditions. And in there, we figured out that they don't indemnify you for anything. So you can use it for free, but you can still be sued by the copyright owner.
All right. Well, that's scary.
Yeah.
That is very scary. You've talked before with me about a situation in a movie. So
Oh, yes. So, yes. Okay.
Okay. You know where
yes,
I'm going with this.
Yes, you do.
Okay.
Well, with copyright. So with copyright infringement, I think my favorite copyright story is the Mike Tyson tattoo story. So,
and what was the movie?
It was Hangover 2.
Okay.
So Hangover 2, the new bachelor was Ed Helms, and he came out of the bathtub with Mike Tyson's tattoo. So I'm thinking that the tattoo artist was sitting at home and saw the commercial and said, oh my goodness, wait, they're using my tattoo, my copyrighted tattoo, without my permission. So he filed a lawsuit, and the judge actually, the movie studio, tried to get the action dismissed, of course. And the judge says, well, no, there's enough here. I'm going to let it go on. So they wound up settling. And I just imagine that he, you know, the tattoo artist is sitting in his new beach house sipping a pina colada. Why? Because he spent $55 in the government filing fee or worked with his attorney, protected that copyright, And the movie studio didn't realize it was a protected design. So they used it without his permission. And that opens up a can of worms.
Right. And I think we're making the assumption that they paid this guy off because he still had the tattoo in the final movie.
Exactly. And in the DVDs.
Okay. So at that point in time, they probably got usage rights. And let's talk about that a little bit. Having been in marketing a long time, I commission a lot of people for whether it's photography or artwork and things like that. And I'll pick on photography because so many times, you know, we hire a photographer to shoot and then find out we got to pay a gazillion dollars to actually use the pictures. And then we're limited based on, oh, it's just going to be a picture on the internet versus an ad or social media. And the price points tend to go up. My always thinking is, and you can validate this or have your side of it, is to try to negotiate all this up front so you understand what its ultimate cost is going to be based before you hire somebody to make sure that it's affordable, if you will.
Sure. So whether it's someone, you hire someone to take photographs or you hire someone for a logo or whatever creative work, you're hiring someone to take a video, something like that. You should know up front that the default is the person who takes the photo, creates the logo, the creator, effectively has those copyrights. And the only way for you as the person commissioning or paying for the rights to those, to the copyrights is to get it in writing. Mm-hmm. And the writing has to have specific language and it has to be signed by both parties. That's the ideal. So negotiating it all up front, knowing that fact, and then negotiating is huge advantage.
So that's really getting the rights and the usage just transferred to you and as much as possible.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you told me another story one time about someone who, I think it was an illustration or photography or something like that, where they were supposed to be for T-shirts and they started putting on their websites and maybe I got the story backwards.
Yeah.
But that was a violation of the usage agreement and then they ended up having to pay for all that.
So yes, and you're almost there.
Okay.
But yes, effectively, a website designer, you know, he owned the company and he hired an independent contractor who was a graphic designer to actually create a logo for a company's website. What happened was he was paid for the work, but that was it. And he saw the graphic designer, who was the independent contractor, saw online that the company was using it to sell shirts and hats. So he went back to the website company owner and said, I want more money. And the website, that's where he found me. And I asked him, do you own the copyrights? He said, yes, because I paid for them. And I had to tell him, no, unless it's in writing, you don't own it, unfortunately. And the illustrator, the graphic designer, still owned the underlying logo.
And I think this is an important part of the conversation for those of you listening out there to really take to heart, because we tend not to think about, even though we might sign a contract, realizing that we don't have those long-term rights or our ultimate usage at any point in time. The illustrator, for example, if I hired somebody to do a logo and I don't get those rights transferred to me, he could potentially come back in years and say, man, you were a little tiny company, now you're a big company and I want more money for the work I did.
Exactly. That's exactly right. That's why it's important to understand the issues up front, identify them, and then, as you were saying earlier, negotiate maybe ownership rights. And if I'm a business owner, typically, when we were in the toy business, we wanted to own everything. You don't want anyone else holding the shoe over
Sure.
your head.
Yeah, well, I think about brands, I think about something that's ownable, sustainable, and leverageable. And certainly, it needs to be ownable so people can't, frankly, knock you off really easily. Years ago, we were shooting an ad for a client, and it was in the printing industry. And the creative director came up with this great idea. It was about the fact that, you know, you won't stay up at night if you're using our printer. And he had come up with this idea about putting toothpicks in the guy's eyes, and his eyes are wide open, right, trying to stay awake. And he used some source material, but then decided not to hire the photographer and shoot it himself. And then I think the ad appeared twice in the magazine, and we received a cease and desist and potentially a federal lawsuit. Yeah. And because they deemed that he basically copied his creative work. And while that was all taken care of and there were circumstances that we got out of all of that, there's so many things as you seek, again, because all this stuff, that was... so much stuff on the internet now, it's easy to go, I like that idea, let me kind of tweak it and modify it. And even then, you're still potentially infringing on their copyright issues.
that's actually a really good story. And I think it's important, especially if you're a business owner, to understand the issues, to talk to someone, to talk to other people, to talk to, someone like me or me who understands the issues and can just help you navigate all the landmines that are sitting around.
Right. So when we talk about, again, potential penalties of $150,000, but again, the real penalties could be exorbitant. And I think that a lot of people, and I'm going to talk a little bit about terms and conditions, and I'll kind of roll that in. In this Google age, if you will, we tend to real quick just to hop on the internet, type in a few words and say, hey, I need a contract. I need this. I need that. And you find something that's sort of like what you want, but you kind of start tweaking it, even though you're not a lawyer, and you use those pieces. I know it's the nails on the chalkboard. But so that's dangerous because we really don't know in a sense of what we're modifying or changing, which potentially while you might have saved yourself a few dollars, you're potentially leaving yourself wide open because if it ever got challenged, you don't really have a legal stand.
Well, I want to take you with me everywhere I go so you can explain that to people, make my life a lot easier. But essentially, you're right. A lot of times a client or a potential client will say, oh, I have this NDA. Great. What is your NDA sign? What does it say? It's a non-disclosure agreement. Oh, I got it off the internet. They're all the same. They're not. And I think a perfect example is I had worked with someone years ago after they had signed a licensing agreement. And it said licensing on the top. And what happened was she was the brand owner, and she licensed it to a bigger company. She had a question. I didn't meet her until after she signed her agreement. I don't know whether she read it or not. And then she asked me about something different. So I said, well, let me read the whole agreement. And I asked her, do you realize that you gave away your rights because it was an option contract and they took the option, you no longer own your brand? And she was incredulous. Mm. She couldn't believe it. So back to your point, you can think it says something, but your concerns are different. You want to know what is in that contract. You want to know that your concerns are being addressed.
Recently, I was working with a company and part of their offering was a PDF that technically you buy from another company. And you could either buy one at a time or you could buy the whole package. And so they took the whole package that they bought and felt that they own those now and actually placed them on the internet so their customers could download them.
Oh, wow.
And it didn't take long before I think probably some bot was scrubbing the website looking for their materials on places that weren't supposed to be. And they got a cease and desist. And again, we were able to, react to that to make sure that there were no legal implications. People have to step back and look because we're talking about business growth here and things that could impact growth.
Correct.
And this is not something you plan on, right? You think about competition, you think about
Correct.
Product, and all of a sudden something like this could come along and just
could bankrupt
really,
the company.
Could really hurt really, your bottom line.
Yeah, great.
So that's really important. I know we're going to run out of time before we finish. So I want to talk about the loss of a trademark. Unfortunately,
okay.
I've been in that seat where I set I did it once through, one of those services. I won't name them. One time I did it myself. I set it, I got it, and forgot it. And the next thing you know, I got a notice that I tossed in the drawer because, hey, what did I care about? The government was calling me up. Next thing you know, my trademark is free and loose again.
Oh.
And I managed to get it back before somebody snatched it because it was about 10 years into my company at the time. And I had competitors, and they were already trying to steal my URLs and surrounding me. How can companies protect themselves about, again, a major potential issue and financially devastating that they lose their stuff?
Right. That's a great point. So for your issue, it's really lucky that you got it back because what normally would happen is if someone else came in, you would actually have to take legal action and sue them to invalidate the trademark if someone else had swooped in. What you need to do is, work with an attorney or make sure that that attorney is going to follow the dates that are necessary for your trademark. A trademark is like a child. So you can't just, dress it and send it out. You have to actually, you have to feed it. You have to take care of it as it grows because, like a child. So the trademark needs renewing as long as you're actually using it. Otherwise, you'll lose it. And again, if someone has a trademark and they don't have an attorney of record, find an attorney. I mean, I do that for people all the time. They'll, just become the attorney of record and docket it for them to make sure that they don't lose their valuable rights.
Okay. So I'm getting the high sign over here. We're probably about 3 minutes out, believe it or not. A couple more questions. So What are three or five actions or tips that you can give the audience that they should kind of check their status of their marks and the usage of photographers, whatever it happens to be? So what are some guidelines that you can provide the audience?
Okay. So for pretty much any business, there are a few steps you can take. One, identify what intellectual property the business has.
Okay.
Two, make sure you own the intellectual property. Three is protect the intellectual property to the extent it makes sense to. Then, to make sure that everything is in writing, that you know what your contracts say. Read your contracts. Definitely important.
Read those.
Read. Then also to have website policies, if you have a website.
So and privacy policy, terms and conditions.
Correct. Because those will help prevent lawsuits from the government.
And by the way, I'm going to interrupt.
Consumers, yeah.
But don't download those from the internet either.
Yes.
And assume that what you can buy for free or steal from somebody else's website applies to you.
Yes. It could be copyright infringement, and probably it's not actually, explaining what your business is doing.
Right. One of my final questions then is, we're both small business owners. So when you think about growing your business, what keeps you up at night?
Oh, wow. Just to be able to continue to provide personalized attention and practical solutions for my clients. So I try to read and stay up on things and make sure I'm nimble for them.
Do you have any specific stories that relate to what keeps you up?
Maybe not specific stories, but I would definitely, I'm always thinking of ways to get more time to implement some of the things I want to do for my business, maybe more speaking engagements or be on more shows like these.
Yeah, time. That's a precious commodity for all of us. All right. So thank you so much. Why don't you tell our listeners how they can contact you, email, website?
Sure. You can go to my website. It has my contact information. It's Pottick Law, PottickLaw.com. My email is there, Stephanie@PotticLaw.com, or connect with me on LinkedIn. Thank you so much for having me. I cannot believe how quickly it went.
I know, Stephanie. And we're going to have to do this again because there are so many other topics. So we're going to get you back next year, which is only, 45 days away. So anyway, thank you out there for joining us at the cafe today. You can find out more about me and read my blogs at theponzigroup.com or connect with me on LinkedIn. And you can subscribe to our show at thebusinessgrowthcafe.com, or we are now on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, and coming soon to Stitcher, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, and other places around the world.
Nice.
Join me next week for lunch at the Business Growth Cafe. Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to today's discussion at the Business Growth Cafe with your host, Angelo Ponzi. Take a moment to subscribe to this podcast and visit our website at www.businessgrowthcafe.com. Read Angelo Ponzi's blogs at www.theponzigroup.com.